was lost in shame, could not get past my blame until he called my name. I'm so glad he changed me. Darkness held me down, but Jesus pulled me out. I'm no longer bound. I'm so glad he changed me. See, I'm now a new creation.
Song choir this morning, and isn't it good to know that your name is written down in glory? And once it's written down, it cannot be erased. It's indelible ink, and it's always there. And we have that assurance because when Christ paid the penalty for our sins, beloved, he bears those marks even there in heaven, as John tells us. And praise God, we've got a new name, a new identity, and it's important that we live that life of faith, resting in whose we are. And that our identity is in Christ. You know, so many will sell the blessings that are theirs for a bowl of porridge, right? but not us. We walk by faith and we trust and rest in all that God has done for us and all that we are in Christ. I want to invite you to praise Him this day as we celebrate here at South River Baptist Church. And maybe you want to come and pray for someone to have their name written down in glory this morning. Maybe you're burdened for them. Maybe they were here yesterday with one or two other people, or 1,000 or 2,000 yesterday. It was kind of crazy, but praise the Lord. And praise the Lord for all those who heard the gospel yesterday. And let's even pray this morning that that seed that was sown in their heart would be watered, and that they would discover that they too can be made new in Christ. And so we're coming this morning, we're laying our hearts before the Lord, praising Him and thanking Him for our new identity in Christ, praying for others who don't know the Lord yet, that they would come to know Him, and maybe bringing a burden, something that you need to roll over on the Lord this morning and ask for wisdom and guidance and direction, crying out to Him. He is near and not far to all who call out to Him. And so let's do that this morning. Bring your burdens, bring your praises, and let's celebrate a great and awesome God who has done great and mighty things in our lives through Christ Jesus. Will you pray with me this morning? Praise Your name, Father in heaven. Lord, we were once enemies. We were children of wrath. We were sons of disobedience. But You showed mercy. You changed our identity. You gave us life when we were dead in trespasses and sins. You made us sons and daughters of the Most High God when once we were sons of disobedience. Lord, You gave us an eternal destiny of security and provision and hope. Lord, we were destined for doom. God, we praise You. All of that is possible because of Your mercy and grace that You've shown us in Christ Jesus. May we rise today and celebrate our identity in Him. May we live the life You desire us to live, trusting in Him, resting in Him, filled by His Spirit and filled with Your Word. God, we come today. We know those around us who desperately need a new identity, Lord. They're in need of a transformation, Lord, and only You can bring that in their hearts. We lay them before Your throne today, along with many thousands yesterday, Lord, who came here, Lord, and heard the gospel. Lord, we pray that that seed that was planted in some hearts, watered in others, Lord, that it would in due time bring forth eternal fruit. Lord, that's our prayer. That's what we celebrate today. Lord, fill our hearts with Your Spirit. Lord, may we have hearts that are ready to praise You and celebrate You, and also that come burdened, Lord, to know Your will and Your ways and to be guided in the paths before us, Lord. We ask this today for Your glory, for our good, and all of it in the precious name of Jesus, our coming King. Amen and amen. Amen. Again, it's good to see you this morning in the house of the Lord at South River Baptist Church. And as you're gathered this morning with us, if you're visiting today for the first time, you're our special guest. And we just have one request of you, if you don't mind, just remain seated for a moment and allow our church family to come welcome you into the house of the Lord. We're going to do that right now. South River family, you brothers and sisters in Christ, stand at this time. Greet one another in the name of the Lord. If you see a guest around you, make them feel welcome in God's house.
right, let's go ahead and gather back together and let's be ready to praise the Lord together this morning. We have victory in Jesus, for whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory, even our faith. Who is the one who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God?
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I've heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory.
For the victory we have through Jesus, even in our faith, because we trust him and we know he is our almighty God. We live by faith and we walk by faith. Let's give our praise to the Lord.
By faith we see the hand of God in the light of creation's grand design, in the lives of those who prove his faithfulness, who walk by faith and not by sight. By faith our fathers roamed the earth with the power of his promise in their hearts, of a holy city built by God's own where peace and justice reign. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on him. Church was called to go, in the power of the Spirit to the lost, to deliver captives and to preach good news in every corner of the earth.
We will stand.
We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the word is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight.
Yes, He has called us to walk by faith, and by faith in Him, we can move mountains for the glory of God.
By faith this mountain shall be moved, and the power of the gospel shall prevail. For we know in Christ all things are possible. For all who come upon His name, we will stand as children of the promise. Our eyes on Him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward, till the
our God calls us to not walk according to our own path, our own ways, but to trust Him by faith. And by faith, He will lead us. He will guide us. And He gives us the victory in Christ through our faith. So it's not that we just have faith when we come to Him and when we're saved, but we have faith every single day to trust Him, to believe Him, to walk in the ways that He guides us. And how many of you this week, I have to confess, there were times when I didn't trust God enough by faith. We do it, right? We recognize, we falter, and we fail. But we need to look to Him in the midst of those times and turn back to Him and trust Him by faith. Really realize that God is a God who gives us not just the second chance. He gives us thousands of chances day after day to trust Him and to walk by faith. We know that because of His Word. And we trust His Word because His Word is true. When we open God's Word in the midst of our worship, what happens? God speaks. And I need Him to speak today. I need Him to speak every single day, every moment to me, to guide me, because I'm a person who falters and fails. But remember what the disciples went through. They're in the garden. And as we look to the Word this morning, may it challenge us and may God speak to us through His Word. From Matthew 26. Then He said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me." He went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, If it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping and said to Peter, What? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. We recognize that our flesh is weak. We may desire to do what's right. But he says, watch and pray. And trust me, Peter. Trust me, Chris. Trust me, James, Andrew. Trust me, and I will guide you through those moments of temptation. So as we continue to worship, realize that we need him every day. We need him every moment.
Oh God, how I need you.
the cry of our heart this morning, each one of us. Thank you, God, that we can worship the one who is our righteousness, that we have no hope apart from Jesus. But Lord, we realize that when we face temptation, we can't face it on our own. God, when we're tempted, help us not to have our own sense, but Lord, to fall on you, because you are our only hope. You are our righteousness, and we only stand in victory when we stand with you and in the victory that you've given us. God, thank you that we need you every day, and we need you every moment of every hour, because this life is a surrendered life. It's an exchange life. It's a life where we give up our sin and we exchange that for the life and the righteousness of Christ. Oh, so much to celebrate. God, thank you that you guide us. Lord, as we give today, help us to please you so that the truth that Jesus is our only hope will go throughout this community and around the world. And God, I pray that the seed that was shared yesterday will fall on fertile soil. And God, may we and may you see a fruit from that word, because you promise that your word will not return void. We love you. Thank you in Jesus' name.
Willing to aid you, he
Amen. Thank you, Trio. What a wonderful reminder this morning. We need Jesus to carry us through. And the children, you're heading off to Children's Church in a moment. We'll be opening God's Word and learning how daily we need to be crying out to God to help carry us through life. And they're going off to learn and study God's Word. And I want you to grab your copy of God's Word as we're getting close to finishing the Lord's Prayer here in Matthew chapter 6. So if you'll turn there, we're learning about praying for our daily needs as we cry out to God to carry us through life. And that impacts our past and our present. And as we'll learn today, even our future. There's four prayers that you and I should be offering up on a regular basis after we acknowledge that our Father in heaven is there and He's caring for His children and He wants us to call out to Him. After we recognize He's not only our Father, but He's also a King and He's the Lord, and it's His will that we want in our lives. And we're learning as we pray this prayer that there's really four things that we're asking for God to do in our lives after we acknowledge who He is and His rightful place in our life. And that is, we want Him to give and forgive. And today we realize we need to pray for Him to lead us and to deliver us. All aspects of my life, all aspects of your life, depend on us crying out to Him and asking for God to, as they just sang, carry us through. I mean, our past sins need forgiveness. And as we learned last week, we need to ask for God to forgive us and forgive those that are in debt to us. We know that we need to pray for our present needs, the provisions. That's why we ask Him, give us this day our daily bread. But today, we want to talk about our future, what's ahead of us. And that's our future pathway. And I don't know about you, but I don't always go down the right path. Sometimes I have to learn the hard way, and sometimes the Lord corrects me to get me back on the right path. And that's why I need daily to be looking to Him to guide me and to direct me. And in the previous verse, as we learned last week, there's a connection here. Because last week we learned of the need to ask for forgiveness and to be willing to forgive others that are in debt to us, that have sinned against us. And today we need to learn that I'm going to be in battle with temptation just as I have in the past and just as others are around me. And I need to cry out to God to give me direction and guidance on the path ahead. And if you don't think you need guidance and you can manage on your own, like a lone ranger, right? You got it all figured out. You can manage it. I mean, I know sometimes teenagers can act like that, right? They know everything. I've got several right now. And but my word to them is, you know, we've been in your shoes before. We were there once too. And some of us still are, right? And we need to realize and recognize I daily need to cry out for God for direction, because I don't know what is over the horizon. I don't know what's around the bend. I don't know all the things that are about to happen, and I need God's direction in my life. Major decisions that perhaps you're considering, you're at a crossroads in life or some entry point in. You know, the devil will use some things in your life. He'll allow goodness to come into your life. He'd love just to puff us up sometimes and then bring us down in a big fall. Because then he just celebrates that and sees the disgrace that he brings on the Lord and on His kingdom. What we need to realize as parents is, as we're teaching our children to fear the Lord, as Proverbs would teach us, and we're helping them to learn those early lessons in life, that, you know, the first steps of walking in wisdom is fearing the Lord. And we need to learn that, and we need to help our kids to learn that. Because one of the most important decisions that they need to learn is they need to fear the Lord, and they need to learn to trust in Him and listen to Him, because He's speaking. A Lady Wisdom is speaking to us each and every day. She's crying out with a megaphone from the tops of the buildings, at every crossroads, at every gate, every doorway. She's saying, you're about to make a decision. You've got to turn left or right or go straight ahead. You've got to make a decision. You're about to try something new on the other side of that door. Are you listening to Lady Wisdom? Because sometimes she's warning you not to go through that door. She's warning you not to make that choice and go down that side street that will not bring joy in your life, but it's a temptation and it's a warning. And if you don't listen and you're not discerning, see, Lady Folly is saying the same thing. She's crying out as well, right there beside Lady Wisdom. And And she just twists what Lady Wisdom says just enough for the foolish ones who think they can figure it out on their own. They don't need Lady Wisdom. They despise her to go down a different pathway, and then they suffer. And as parents, we're trying to teach our children, listen, choices have consequences, and you need to be wise about those paths ahead. And when you make a decision, you need to realize that we desperately need Jesus' direction. We need his guidance. That's why this book right here that we're about to read and stand and read, it says over in the Psalms that it is a lamp for our feet and a light for our path. In other words, every step that I take with this lamp can be illuminated by God's word. And the pathway before me, it can be illuminated as well, the general direction in which I need to go. But that means I have to listen to the Lord's leaning. I have to have a heart inclined for that. And what I've discovered in my walk with Christ is that that's a daily routine, yearning for him to lead me and guide me and direct me, lest my feet go down a pathway that's not illuminated and goes into some darkness. Lest I choose the wrong pathway and I experience some turmoil because of it. And I need that daily. You need that daily. And the amazing thing is God's not just given us his word, he's also given us his spirit. And so that's why we pray now for the Spirit of God to help us to write this on our hearts, to ask that the Lord would inscribe this on our hearts and chisel it there so that I learn daily to live of my dependence upon the Lord, upon his spirit, and upon his words. Stand with me in honor of the word of the Lord as we're learning how to pray. Not praying today for our basic needs or a merciful heart, but praying for the direction ahead as we all have to battle against the temptations and the attacks of the devil that will certainly come. Matthew chapter 6, Jesus' model prayer. We're almost done with it. We'll focus on verse 13 today. And in this manner, therefore, Jesus said, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And here it is today. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Father in heaven, we simply realize today the path ahead, only you know it fully, because you know all things. You know the beginning and the end. God, you know what traps, what obstacles the devil will put before us so that, Lord, in that trial that we experience, Lord, he wants us to fail. But you want us to succeed. And you call us to walk by faith and trust you. And so today, grant us eyes of faith and grant us ears to hear and hearts that want to obey. And realize, Lord, we daily need you. Lord, we need you. Oh, we need you. God, make yourself known to us today. And Lord, for those who may have chosen the wrong pathway, Lord, and those who have gone down a side street today, may they realize that if we'll turn and repent and run back to you, you are there with gracious and merciful arms to receive us back into right relationship with you. We love you and we praise you. And we ask this all in Jesus' name and for his sake. And all God's people said amen and amen. We are praying today for detection. We are praying a very simple prayer. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. When you see those two last words there, temptation and the evil one, what we realize is we need to be able to detect what is going on around us and be discerning. We live in a fallen world. We recognize we have an enemy, someone who wants us to be destroyed. He wants us to fail. And the curse of sin that affects everything in the created order has infected our lives because of the choices of Adam and Eve. And because of their choices, there's an enemy that's deceived them and wants to deceive you and deceive me. And he's very sly. He's been practicing on mankind for several thousand years now. And so he's really good. And so if I'm going to be walking and navigating through life and going down the pathways of life, I need to be very discerning and pray for detection to understand what is God's will and what is the enemy's temptation. Now remember, this is Matthew chapter 6. What happened before the Sermon on the Mount? Well, over there in Matthew chapter 4, Jesus was tempted. You remember, for 40 days and 40 nights, he was fasting and praying, and it was there that the devil came and tempted him. And so what he is teaching us to pray for, and teaching his disciples to pray for, is something that he had just experienced, right? He had been tempted in all ways, and yet without sin, amen? And when he was tempted in all those ways, what he was proving and demonstrating is that he was the perfect lamb that God had sent into this world, and that he had overcome every temptation, so that when he goes to the cross, he hangs there and dies for you and for me as the spotless Lamb of God, the perfect sacrifice. But what he's telling the disciples to pray for right now, he himself has experienced. And every Christian will experience this. Even after we're saved, sometimes it feels as though the temptations are even more involved, right? Because you know why? The Spirit of God dwells within us, and the Word of God dwells within us. And we begin to realize all the ways that sin has infected this world and affected our lives. And so we realize we desperately need to look to the Lord and trust in Him and begin to detect what's going on around us. And when it says there, deliver us from the evil one, some versions, some scripture, some translations may just say from evil. Well, is it evil or the evil one? Well, beloved, the evil one is the author of all the evil, right? God is not the author of evil. The evil one is. And when we listen to him and listen to his deceptions and believe his lies and don't embrace truth and walk by faith, then we experience some of the consequences of those choices, and that is the death or destruction that will come because of sin. And he desires to destroy our lives. He wants to destroy you and your family. He wants to destroy marriages and relationships. In fact, he wants to undermine the work of God's people. He wants to sow discord among the brethren. He wants to have us accuse the brethren. He wants us to put obstacles before us so we trip of them and we disgrace the Lord. And this is the enemy that we battle against. And you need to be understanding. Don't stick your head in the sand and act like there isn't an enemy out there, because he is at work right now trying to destroy as many individuals as he can who are made in the image of God, because he cannot defeat God. And so he has to attack those that are in God's image and disgrace him, disgrace the Lord who made them. And we need to pray for detection. God, help me to realize as I go forward in life what the temptation might be to turn away from your best, to turn away in disobedience, because we're all going to be tempted. Now, it's not just the devil out there that is our worst enemy. Sometimes it's our flesh. You see, this flesh is wicked. It's fallen. It's affected by sin. We have fallen natures. And what we need to realize, that listen, even the Apostle Paul would say this over in Romans chapter 7. He had been justified, right? Romans chapter 4, 5. He had learned, it was learning sanctification, chapter 6. But then he makes the argument in chapter 7 about the presence of sin in our lives. And Paul would say, listen, the things that I want to do in life, I don't do. And the things that I do, I don't want to do. Oh, wretched man that I am. Who will set me free from this body? And that's where he has that wonderful, wonderful verse in chapter 8 where he says, blessed be the Lord, that there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So Paul realizes, listen, there's things in my life that I should be doing that I'm not doing. There's things that I am doing I ought not to be doing. My heart is desperately wicked. In fact, that's what Jeremiah said over in Jeremiah 17. Verse 9, he said, the heart is deceitful above all things. It is desperately wicked. Who can know it? Only the Lord. John would say it this way, or in 1 John chapter 1, did you know that sometimes our hearts will deceive us and lie to us, especially if the truth or the Word of God is not in us? It'll tell you you're better than what you are. It'll tell me, listen, everything's fine. You're not really in disobedience. And my heart can lie to me and deceive me to not really see things as God sees them. And that's why I desperately need the Lord to guide and direct my steps. Because without Him, I'm going to take a step into darkness or away from Him. We have desires and hungers within our heart, and we all have the capacity to sin. It dwells within us, and except by the grace of God, there go I. And we need to realize that and recognize every day I need to be praying for God to help me detect what is going on in my life. In the midst of a trial, to realize God is allowing that into my life, listen, so that you and I will learn to depend on Him and walk by faith. And He allows those trials to shape us and to form us and to stretch our faith. But the devil will use those trials in a way in our life to tempt us. And I need to realize that in the midst of that, sometimes my flesh and my heart is a problem. The heart is the problem, right? The problem of the heart is the heart. Because out of this heart comes forth all kinds of evil things. It's what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 15 and verses 17 through 20. When I'm tempted, when you're tempted, as James says over in James chapter 1, there's some bait that's thrown out there. We are enticed. And the devil's a good fisherman, right? He knows how to, you know, use a live bait, and he'll flick that out there like a fisherman dove. Or he says, well, you won't bite on that one. Let me put a different kind of lure on there. And he'll flick that out there and say, try this one. And he'll say, well, that one's not working. Let's get a jig, and we'll throw that one out there. And that's what a good fisherman knows. He's got a lot of ways to catch fish. Well, the devil's got a lot of ways to tempt us. And he'll find the one bait that will entice you, that will entice me. And it may not be the same for us. It might be different. But he is very crafty, very skillful at it. And so I have to be asking for God to give me discernment. And when temptation comes, for God to give me strength in that battle so that I don't give into that enticement. I love to go to the beach. I love the beach. My bride loves the mountains, and we live in between here, right? So we can go either direction, enjoy both. But when I go down to the beach and I have to wash off some of that sand that you get when you're walking up and down the beach, and you step down into those waves, and as you step there just into the shallow part, and you kind of just sink your feet down into the sand a little bit and let those waves come up and go back and forth and just listen to that sound. You know, during high tide, as those waves come in a little bit higher and higher, and where it's just at your feet and then it's at your ankles and your feet get a little solid there, you can start to feel the tug of the ocean. And the waves come, and as that tide comes in, it just tugs you a little bit harder and a little bit harder, and you wonder if you're going to be able to stand. And that's what temptation does. It comes and entices us, and the devil tries to bait us and draw us in, and it tugs and it tugs. And if you and I don't learn to take the right stand or to stand with the Lord, then we will fall into that wave and be overcome by it and be tempted in that way, in such a way that then we will suffer. I don't know what's beeping here. I apologize if that's me. The devil doesn't want you to hear what I'm saying right now. Amen. Because some of you are being tempted by things in this world, things in your flesh, and you're being pulled away. And he just said, don't listen to that tug. That tug is not for you. It's for your neighbor beside you. Be on guard that the devil will use what he will deceive you to think you're doing well. It's your neighbor who needed to hear what the preacher just said. And it's every single one of our hearts that need to hear what I just said. Because apart from God's grace, beloved, we're going to fall, and we will fall, and no one needs to experience all the damage that comes from sin and the collateral damage as it affects others. We're praying now, God, I need to be able to realize what's happening in the world around me, and I need you to guard me. Now listen, when we're tempted in that way, it's the evil one who's trying to get us to fail, not God. God is not the author of evil. And if we fail in that temptation, it's not God's fault. In fact, we love today to play the victim card. It's always someone else's fault, right? The circumstances we were in, some other individual. You just don't know what I'm going through. No. When you sin, you make a choice. It is your will. And if that will is not surrendered to God, then that will has sinned against a holy God. And it's that will that God is upset with and has to deal with. We're not victims. Listen, when Adam was in the garden, that was a perfect place. And he was tempted. When Jesus was tempted, he was in the wilderness and he didn't sin. So don't tell me if someone just had a little better experience, a better place, they wouldn't have given in to the sin. No, Jesus has shown us that even in the worst places, you can overcome sin and the temptation. We are not victims, but you can be a victor if you'll trust in the Lord and ask him, God, help me to have detection. I need to realize that. So I'm not overcome by temptation. Well, what am I asking for? I'm asking for God to direct my steps. I need direction. You need direction. God, do not lead us into temptation. By asking him to lead us, we're acknowledging we don't always know the best path ahead. We depend on him. We need his guidance and his direction. Now, what's the role of the Spirit of God? Jesus said, I'm going to send another comforter, and when he comes, what's he going to do? He will guide you into all truth. He will show you and show me the right pathway for life. He will show us how to navigate life, and yet I daily need him to do that. That Spirit does that through the Word of God. That Word is the lamp and the light. It shows us the little steps we need to take, and the pathway we need to go in. And those paths are right paths. And we need to pray for that direction. Because without the work of the Spirit of God in my heart, without the map given in the Word of God, I will not navigate life the right way. And I need to trust in the Lord. Now here's the amazing thing. When God leads us and guides us into a trial, the devil most likely will try to tempt us so that we fail. And when we experience that, we need to cry out to God to direct us and guide us and say as a prayer that we should have already been praying, your will be done. Not my will, but your will be done, because you're the Lord. And as I'm in the midst of that temptation, I need to rest on the promises that God has given me, and that is this. No temptation that I experience, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. No temptation that you and I experience has overcome us, because God is faithful and will not allow us to be tempted beyond our ability. No temptation shall overcome you that is not common to man, Paul says. In other words, when you're going through that experience, you're not the only one going through that experience. Other individuals are going through that experience. And here's the promise. You have a Savior who was tempted in all ways and yet without sin. And it's his Spirit that dwells within you and me to help us in the midst of that temptation. It's not only common to man, God is faithful. He will not allow us to be tempted beyond what we are able. He is present with us. He is there. He's still in control on his throne. And he wants to guide us and tempt us, guide us and help us in the midst of that temptation so that we succeed. And he is faithful if we will cry out to him. You and I should know when we're tempted, we will not be tempted beyond our ability. It's God who will supply when we look to him. When you feel like you're stretched beyond your limits, God is stretching your faith and my faith to trust in him and to rest in him so that we don't have to give in to the temptations, the thorns that come in our life, but we can cry out to him for strength. And the best part of what 1 Corinthians 10:13 says is this, and he who is faithful will do this. He will make a way of escape. There is some way out in the midst of the temptation. And we're praying, God, direct me to that way out. Now, here's the amazing thing. A lot of people try to live their life in 1 John chapter 1, 9, and I'm glad that verse is there. That it, when we fall into temptation and we sin, that praise the Lord, that when we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And I'm grateful that that verse is there. But as Christians, we actually should be living in Romans chapter 6. In Romans chapter 6, verses 6 through 18, daily. Not thinking, well, I'm going to fail and I can just cry out for God's grace and mercy to forgive me and to cleanse me. Yes, that's there. But if you wake up with the mindset that I'm going to falter, you will falter. Instead, Romans 6 teaches that as believers, being sanctified now, every day I present myself as a slave unto righteousness. As a slave of righteousness that will lead unto holiness. And when I live that way daily, recognizing, God, I need you today. I present myself today. I just want to be an instrument of righteousness in your hand. I want to go down the right paths in life. God, I know there's going to be temptations today. And when they come, Lord, do not lead me in that direction. Show me the way of escape. I don't want to give into that any longer. Jesus, you've delivered me from that. I don't have to have that desire within my heart anymore. You can crucify that desire. And no longer do I have to fall into sin. And this is called mortifying the flesh. And we need to learn to do that more frequently. When you see sin and the effects of it and the destruction that it brings, you cry out to God and you say, God, have mercy. Purge that from my life. I don't want that in my life anymore. I don't want that in my life. I want to walk in the paths of righteousness. And as believers, we're supposed to be presenting ourselves daily into that. And as we do that, that reveals to us not only the righteous path, but it leads us unto holiness. And then you're not having to pray 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. But praise God, it's still there when we do stumble and fall. And the righteous one, though they stumble seven times, they still get back up. And they look to the Lord and turn to Him. You don't have to be overcome by temptation, though. God has a way of escape. And you can experience victory moment by moment, day by day, just as Jesus did. Listen. By resting on the power of the Spirit of God within you and the Word of God within you to guide and direct. And so we pray, God, direct my steps, orient my path, help me be going in the right direction. If you're right now going in the wrong direction, then repent. Shuv is the Hebrew term, Turn back to God and start walking in the right direction as the Word of God guides you and directs you. And let the Spirit of God give you some fortitude so that when the temptation comes, you won't fall in. As you're praying for direction, God, show me the right path because I've been going down the wrong path. You're also praying for deliverance. God, deliver us from the evil one. This is a very strong term. This means rescue me. Snatch me out because I realize I'm in danger. And we're praying for God to deliver us from that. We need protection from Satan. Now, understand this. God is not calling you and I to go and confront Satan. We will not experience victory that way. I know there's a lot of people going, well, you know, we can battle against Satan. You're a fool. You know why? Because the Word of God says this. He never says engage the enemy. In fact, Jude says you better be on guard against doing that. What the Word of God says is this. If you and I will draw near to God, the devil will flee from us. My strength is not within me to battle the devil. The strength is the only one who has defeated the devil, and that's Jesus. And I need to draw near to Him. And when I draw near to Him, I can tell you the devil does not want to be around God. The reason sometimes we're falling and failing is because, you know what? We're resting in our own ability, thinking, I got this, I can handle it. Instead of crying out to Him, God, deliver me from the evil one. I need you to snatch me out of this situation. I need you to pull me out of this because I am in a desperate place. Deliver me from evil. You know, one of my favorite hymns is in the Baptist hymnal. It's number 8, and yet it's not written by a Baptist. It's written by the first Lutheran, Martin Luther. Now listen. 500 plus years ago, he penned this hymn. And yet, it is so real today when you listen to it. Though this world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, We will not fear, for God hath willed His truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, but we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure. Why? For lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fail him. What little word? That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them, abideth. The Spirit and the gifts are ours through him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill. His truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. His kingdom is forever. Beloved, that little word that defeats the devil is Jesus. And we need to be calling out to him, crying out to him to deliver us when temptation comes, when the devil and his demons put something for us, or just when our flesh longs for something. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. My identity is in you. I died with you on the cross. My penalty was paid. My identity is there. I was buried with you. My sin is in the grave, and it's no longer hanging over my head. The penalty's been paid. I don't need to carry this guilt. You were raised from the dead. So am I, because my identity is in you. And you are seated at the right hand of the Father, as Paul would say in Ephesians chapter 1, these are the blessings that we have. We forget whose we are and what he's done. That little word is the key to victory. And that little word needs to dwell in your heart and my heart this morning if you want to experience victory. I mean, I love a victory in Jesus. It's my favorite hymn. Well, I got a lot of favorite hymns, I'm sorry. But this is what I know. Only he can give me victory. And the reason some of us are not having victory and experiences it, because we're not crying out to him and asking him, not even trusting in him. He is the only one that's defeated the enemy. And I will never experience victory. You will never experience victory in your own strength. We must depend on him completely, because he can give me victory over temptation. We don't have to be a victim. By the way, not only did he pay the penalty for my sin, now he gives me the Spirit of God within me, who gives me victory over the power of sin in my life when I'm walking in the Spirit, not in the flesh. And ultimately, he's going to deliver us from the presence of sin, and we'll never have to deal with it again. Praise the Lord. Why? Because of what he did at Calvary. But here's the key. You have to trust in him. Now listen, you say, well, I trusted in Jesus. I gave him my life 27 years ago. No, beloved, this is a daily trusting in him, a daily resting in him. It is a daily death to self and finding life in Christ. It's the crucified life. It's the extinguished life. I die to self, and I find life in Christ. That's my identity. This is Paul would say in Galatians chapter 2, I am crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. There must be a point where you do acknowledge, God, I'm a sinner. Have mercy on me. I can't save myself. I deserve the wages of sin, but Jesus died on this cross for me. And I want to put my trust in his sacrifice. And I want to ask him to come and be my Savior and my Lord and dwell within me. But every day I grow in deeper dependence upon him. A recognition that I daily, desperately need him. And I'm supposed to be trusting in the one who has defeated the enemy. And if we're not doing that, beloved, we're going to have defeated lives. And the devil's just going to be saying, yep, there's another one. There's another one. And the testimony of our faith and of our Lord is tarnished. You know something that's amazing? When Jesus was tempted, he resisted all the way to the point of shedding blood. Amazing. he was tempted in that way. And the temptation for him was not to go to the cross and not die for you and for me. And yet, beloved, he did. He did the will of the Father. When I stumble, when I fall short, I fall on my knees and say, God, I've fallen short. Have mercy on me. Forgive me, Lord. Please crucify that desire. Don't let it lord over me. Don't let it reign over me. Lord, my identity is in your Son. And Father, I pray that you would help me to rest, that it's all been paid for and covered by the blood. But transform my life. Help me to put off this old and put on this new. Jesus, I praise you and I thank you for what you have done for me, what you endured for me. Help me to live in victory. God wants you to experience that this morning. He wants us to experience that day by day. There needs to be the first time, listen, where we acknowledge we're sinners in need of a Savior, and we come and we surrender to Him. We give our hearts to Him. We give our lives to Him and say, God, I know I'm desperate. I can't save myself. I've got nothing to offer you. You require perfection, and I don't have it. But today, I want to ask you to forgive me of my sin. And then you go day by day in the new life that Christ gives us in. And the Spirit of God dwells us. And the Word of God begins to grow in our hearts and in our minds. And it's in that strength that we go forward. And so when we face trials and temptations, we don't have to give in to them. But are you trusting today in the only one who has defeated the enemy? Because if we're not, we're going to fall short. We desperately need Him. In fact, we always have an opportunity for you to respond to God's truth. It's called a time of the altar. It's the altar time. It's when you say, listen, I've heard God speak. The Spirit of God has spoken to me. And this morning, if the Spirit of God has said, you need to be saved, you need to put your faith and trust in Christ, then come take the hand of one of the pastors this morning and say, I need Jesus. Maybe there's been a trial in your life this week, some temptation, and you gave into it, and you're not experienced victory, and you just want to lay it on the altar and say, God, I want to be dead to this flesh. I don't want it to reign or rule in my life anymore. God, I just want to go in newness of life, and I need the Spirit of God to come and to infill me and indwell me once fresh and anew, overflowing, so that I can navigate life, Lord, with victory through the Spirit and through your Word. If you just need prayer this morning, that's why we're here. Listen, this is a house not for perfect people. It's for imperfect people. It's people who realize I need the grace and mercy of God each and every day. I've not arrived. Neither have you, amen? But we desperately need Him. If you want to experience victory today, then you need to come and trust in Jesus. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. The question is, am I trusting in the only one, the Holy One, who has defeated the enemy and can give me victory?